Hello and thanks for joining us live at the Bureau of Meteorology for our Facebook Live event. I'm Adam Morgan, I'm a meteorologist here at the Bureau.
And I'm John O'Howe, I'm also a meteorologist at the Bureau, and we're broadcasting to you live from our Melbourne office, right here from the National Operations Centre.
Yeah, it's kind of like the nerve centre of all things weather in Australia, isn't it, John O? It's been pretty cold over the last few days, hasn't it? Particularly for southern Australia.
Yeah, so we had that cold front move through southeastern Australia over the weekend, and I don't know about you, but on Friday evening, it was pretty warm, it was quite mild across Melbourne, and Saturday morning, bam, cold all over again.
It was also thanks to a series of cold fronts that moved through. And that's exactly why we're here with you today. We're here to answer all of your questions about what is a cold front. It's all part of our video series, Bomb. We're going to ask lots of questions about the weather. So we've put together this series of videos to answer some of them. And the first one we're going to address today is, what is a cold front? So over the next 15 minutes or so, we'd love you to get into the comments section and type away, ask us all your questions, and we'll do our best to answer them.
Absolutely.
And on that one, we'll go up first question from Diane. How does a cold front form, Jono?
Yeah, so a cold front in its simplest terms is basically a transition zone between a warm air mass and a cold air mass. And the cold front actually marks the boundary of where that cold air is pushing out that warmer air mass. So that's why we see with a cold front, we see warmer conditions ahead of the cold front, and behind the cold front, it's just basically just cooler air coming through.
Yeah, that's right. When we look at a weather map, we often look at those blue lines that you see with the little triangles poking out from the front. That indicates a cold front. And it is warmer ahead of the cold front and colder behind it. But why do we get that difference in the warm air in front and the cold air behind? How does that actually form?
Yeah, the best way to think about it is to think of the atmosphere as being a liquid. It's in a constant state of just trying to rebalance itself. And I remember at university, my lecturer actually taught me that the best way to kind of talk about the atmosphere is to think about a cup of tea. So you're making a hot cup of, you know, English breakfast, the Earl Grey, it's hot and it's black. And you add that cold milk, and just as you add it, you see the white milk kind of swirl around, and while the tea's just trying to get that consistent colour, and just so it's ready to drink. And that's what the atmosphere is basically trying to do. The sun causes a lot more heating at the equator, and it's a lot cooler at the poles. And so the Earth needs to find a way to kind of balance that all out. And a cold front is one of those mechanisms of how the Earth just tries to achieve that equilibrium, I guess.
Yeah, you talked about cups of tea. When I think about cold fronts, I like to think of when you jump in a bath and it's too hot, so you turn that cold tap on, and you when you mix that cold water with the warm water, there's all sorts of cold fronts and warm fronts even within the water in the bath, and you swirl around with your hands to try and mix the temperature around to get it to a nice even temperature ready for you to jump in. That's essentially what the atmosphere is doing with cold fronts. Mm-hmm. All right, from Gowrie, we've got another question now. Why do most of the cold fronts approach from the west, Jono?
Yeah, so that basically just comes down to the Earth's rotation. So the Earth rotates from the west to the east, and that's pretty much the main reason why we see our weather systems come through from the west and to the east. So if you're living in southwest WA, they're normally the first place in Australia to get those really strong cold fronts right off the Indian Ocean. So they're pretty much slammed straight away from the cold front. Mm. And a couple of days later, we'll see that cold front move through to the southeast of Australia. So it has to do with the Earth's rotation, basically.
Yeah, if we didn't have any rotation of the Earth, we actually wouldn't get these swirling weather systems like low pressure systems and high pressure systems and the cold fronts and warm fronts that define the boundaries between them. And you talked about how quickly fronts move, or kind of getting from Western Australia through to the east. And I remember when I was little, my nan told me once, living in Melbourne, she told me that whatever weather Perth was having, Melbourne would get it 2 days later. And there is actually an element of truth to that, isn't there?
Yeah, so the thing with weather forecasting is that it's full of these little rules of the trade and little tips and tricks and rules of thumb, and they do exist for a reason. So as you were saying, you know, Perth will get a cold front, just say, on a Monday. And it is fairly confident. You can say that it'll come through like Adelaide and Victoria probably a day to 2 days later. And these kind of rules and tricks are what we used to look at before we had high-tech satellites and observations. And so they do this for a reason, because we've been forecasting these for many decades before even satellites were around.
That's right. I mean, satellite information has really only been around since about the 1960s. Yeah. And back then, we'd only get satellite images every 6 hours or so, and then gradually every 3 hours, and then every 1 hour during the 90s and 2000s. And then only a couple of years ago, now we start getting satellite images every 10 minutes. So we get lots of information now. And in terms of the speed of cold fronts and how quickly they move, if we were to look at a whole bunch of cold fronts over the course of a year, I mean, they all vary at different different speeds. Some are faster than others, but if you average them all out, that time frame, say a couple of days from the west to the east of Australia, is a pretty reliable rule of thumb, isn't it?
Not too bad. Yeah.
All right. Let's move on to the next question from Eunice. Hi, Eunice. How you go? Why do cold fronts mean bad weather?
It's a very good question. And so, when a cold front actually approaches, what happens is the cold air is pushing up the warm air, and as you probably learned from primary school science, hot air rises. And as the air rises, it forms clouds. And so sometimes these clouds produce things like rain, sometimes we get storms, and behind the cold front we get these kind of cold showers. So it has to do with just the air being pushed up.
The cold front kind of wedges in, doesn't it? Cold fronts aren't sort of straight up and down in the atmosphere. Cold fronts actually wedge in from the west, and they slope upwards with height. So as they wedge in, they lift that warm air up, and if that warm air is moist, then that warm air will reach its condensation point, and we'll see cloud form, and that's when we see all the rain, and then sometimes thunderstorms as well on the cold front boundary. So some of the, I guess, most hazardous weather can happen with cold fronts, and we usually think about cold fronts in winter, and certainly they're the ones that bring all the snow in winter to the alpine regions, and heavy rain across southern Australia that helps fill our dams, and strong winds as well, because when there's a strong temperature difference across a cold front, we get very strong winds. But actually in summer as well, we don't necessarily think of summertime being important for cold fronts, but cold fronts can really do some damage in summer as well, can't they?
Yeah, so Australia gets cold fronts throughout the year, and it really depends on the season, as well as where you are in Australia, and that really determines kind of the impact that you feel. And so just talking about a summer cold front, it sticks in my mind is back from Black Saturday 2009, those devastating bushfires across southeast Australia. And what we had in that situation was very hot northwesterly winds at behind that cold front. But behind that, we had a cold front coming through, and ahead of the cold front, we get those really strong, gusty northwesterly winds, and behind the cold front, that sharp westerly change. And that's what actually happened all those years ago, kind of 9 years ago, actually. Just that really strong wind change that brought devastating conditions and very challenging times for fire fighters across southeast Australia.
Yeah, particularly when you live in Melbourne in summer, you know to expect those days where the temperature can drop from around 40 degrees to 20 degrees within half an hour with the passage of a cold front in summer. And we often think of the temperature change being important in a bushfire situation, which it is, and particularly the humidity change across a cold front as well. But it really is that wind direction change that's important, because in a bushfire situation, when we think about those northwesterly winds and northerly winds ahead of a cold front, when you think about how that pushes the fire front, it pushes it from north to south, so you might end up with a really narrow band of a fire front pushing from north to south, and when that wind changes around to those westerlies or southwesterlies, it then pushes that narrow band in completely opposite direction and creates a very long and dangerous fire front.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, let's move on and have another look at another question. Now, it's related from Tala. Hi, Tala. Why does the wind pick up each time it rains?
That's a very good question.
Very good question. Yeah. Thanks for that.
Yeah, that's actually true. So just before, like, you get a heavy downpour shower, your senses just feel a bit of a gust. Mm. And that's basically just gravity doing its work. So if you think about a cloud and all that rain and precipitation in the cloud, it's very heavy.
Yeah, it is.
It's heavy. It's basically water.
Yeah, I mean, if you're carrying a bucket of water or something, there's a lot of weight to it, isn't
there? How I think about it is, if you're in a metro tunnel and before the train comes, you feel that wind coming through, it's basically just the mass of water pushing down from above. And you feel that kind of gust coming through, and then the rain comes through. So it really is the weight of the water acting with gravity.
Yeah, that's like that train, you're pushing that wind through the tunnel, the water pushing down the wind or the air in the atmosphere as the rain falls. And so when you're on the ground ahead of a shower, sometimes you can feel, or even a thunderstorm.
Yeah.
We talk in the weather language about things like gust fronts. And they're mini cold fronts, if you like, that colder air, that colder dense air being helped by the force of gravity with those raindrops falling from within the thunderstorm or the shower and pushing out along the ground ahead of the shower or the area of the shower. So you get this mini cold front, if you like, coming out of the shower or thunderstorm. That's what we call a gust front. Okay, from Tanya. Hi, Tanya. Why do large rain bands seem to build up across Western Australia and then die off close to South Australia and then build up heading to Melbourne? So I guess what Tanya's asking is, how do cold fronts, I guess, strengthen and weaken and strengthen again, or do they do that?
So every cold front is different, and the way I think about it, I always say, is the atmosphere is very multi-layered. So we've got what's happening at the surface, that's where we live, but kind of through the atmosphere, there's all these different things going on, and there's systems in the upper atmosphere and the middle of the atmosphere as well. And so, for example, if a cold front's coming through from the Indian Ocean and hitting Perth, what happens is that sometimes the upper kind of forcing and the upper kind of dynamics actually weaken off by the time they get to Melbourne. sometimes they do strengthen as well. So it has a lot to do with what's going on within the cold front itself. Don't have anything else to add to that, yeah?
Yeah, so we can think of two ways. So those upper level systems certainly do help to weaken and strengthen cold fronts at the surface, but we can also look at that other weather systems at the surface as well. And often when fronts weaken as they come towards the east of the country, it's often got to do with a large high pressure system being located in the Tasman Sea. Mm-hmm. And again, meteorologists might call this a blocking high. If we get a high pressure system in the Tasman Sea that sticks around for a week or more, then those cold fronts moving across from the west of the country tend to just hit that, get blocked by it, and then push down to the south. So where Western Australia might experience some severe weather from cold fronts, the southeast of the country might experience nothing. And the other thing is too, when we think back to those analogies around cups of tea and baths with warm water before, a cold front doesn't live forever. Essentially, the atmosphere, all it's trying to do with fronts is to try and rebalance its energy and its heat. So eventually, cold fronts will do their work, or the circulation around the low pressure systems, which is where cold fronts live, close to low pressure systems. That'll eventually, all that circulation will eventually mix out, and so the strength of the, or the difference in temperature across the front won't be so stark anymore, and so that cold front will weaken over time.
Yeah, all cold fronts do have a lifespan, and there's multiple factors at play, whether they're blocking highs or whether there's something going on in the atmosphere that will cause them to eventually fade out and kind of rebalance the kind of the temperature distribution.
Okay, Megan's got one, and this probably is a nice segue into how we forecast or warn for cold fronts, Jono. Megan says, how do you determine the severity of a cold front?
Yeah, so as weather forecasters, we use a broad range of things. So obviously, we've talked about things like satellites. So satellite has a really good way of us kind of diagnosing how strong a cold front is. So we can kind of look at how thick the cloud is. So thicker the cloud would mean more kind of uplift and more heavy rain and storms. But also, we also use a range of different weather models here at the Bureau. So we use about four different weather models, including...
You talk about computer models,
yeah? Yeah, computer weather models, that's right. So we've got the Australian model, we've got the European weather model, and different other from other agencies around the world. And the job of a weather forecaster is basically analyse these weather models and kind of look at trends of what's been going on and trying to pick out the different attributes of a cold front or indeed kind of any weather system. And because the atmosphere is in a constant state of change, the job of meteorologists is to kind of figure out what kind of impacts there will be. So sometimes the cold front might not bring any rain at all. Sometimes it might be really severe. So it's just kind of up to meteorologists, I guess, to kind of see what's going on.
Yeah, when probably the most common question, I don't know about you, John, but certainly me, when I meet new people or friends, go, what does a weather forecaster actually do? And I kind of liken our job to being a storyteller. We take in all that information that comes in from computer models and satellites, radar, weather stations, and we put it all into a story and we tell that to the community to help the community make the decisions that they need to make day-to-day based on the weather. And going back to that, the issue of severity of cold fronts, often we do have severe weather warnings in winter when we see a cold front. And usually it's generally, a lot of the time it's because of the wind, and we'll issue severe weather warnings if we expect winds or wind gusts greater than 90 kilometres an hour to be associated with cold fronts. And also if there's very heavy rainfall expected as well. In terms of a lot of cold fronts don't bring extremely heavy rain just because they move through quite quickly. So although you might get short, sharp bursts of heavy rain, we don't get or often with cold fronts. We don't often see that prolonged heavy rain that might lead to a flooding risk. But if I just think off the top of my head, one situation where we might see or more commonly see warnings for heavy rainfall and flooding associated with cold fronts is if we get like an East Coast low off the East Coast, isn't that right, Jono?
Then East Coast lows, they bring very damaging kind of weather to the East Coast of Australia, particularly around New South Wales.
Yeah. Okay, and I think on that note, Jono, we're just about out of time. So we've had lots of fun today talking to you all about cold fronts, and this will be the first in a series of Ask Bomb Live segments. We'll try to do one every couple of weeks to gradually answer all of your questions on different topics related to our Ask Bomb series of videos. So we'd encourage you all to go to our YouTube channel and subscribe to the series, and you'll get updates whenever we post a new one. And we'd love you to keep asking questions in the comments section of today's video, and we'll do our best to answer them as the day goes on. So thanks for joining me, Jono.
Thank you, and thanks for watching.
Yeah, and we'll see you next time.
Bye.